Let's welcome in our next guest on the show, Girish Pai, Head Research Institutional Equities, Nirmal Bang Equities, is now joining us. Girish, good morning. What is your outlook for 2017, especially with what has happened in the last 2 months? Are valuations attractive for a long-term investor, like 2 to 3 years investment horizon?
Yeah, so if I look out in the next 12 months, I think the risk-reward is kind of fairly balanced. I think we could potentially see a range of the market between 7,500 to 7,500 to 9,000 on the Nifty over the next 12 months. With, I would probably think, the lower end of the range ruling over the, say, the next 6 to 9 months, and probably the market moving to the higher end of the range towards the end of the calendar year. So I think if you look at, if you disaggregate reasons why I'm saying, that kind of range and that kind of a, in terms of the roadmap as far as the index is concerned, if you look at earnings, my sense is that the domestic oriented sectors will probably face a fair bit of pressure on earnings front in 2017. While we've had one hit from the demonetization side, I think there could be potential hits coming through. One would be, follow through on the on the black money related issues. If the government decides to go after Benami properties in a significant way, then I think there could be some amount of erosion of household wealth, because a lot of household wealth today is actually kind of locked up in real estate at this point in time. Almost 55-60% of household wealth is in real estate. So if that sees a cut because of the demonetization, because of, people going after Benami properties, I think that will probably be felt in discretionary consumption. Second is GST. It's probably going to come through on the 1st of July, or probably a little after that. I think that will also be a disruptive factor in 2017. One doesn't know how really that's going to pan out, but it could definitely hit the medium and small players in the market. So I think on the domestic front, earnings, I think the uncertainty on earnings is probably going to continue for a while, maybe for the entire of 2017. There is another part which is non-domestic, which is export-oriented, which is probably our companies in the regulated sectors. I think there the earnings picture is slightly more stable. I would only call it relatively stable in one sense. So that's the picture on the earnings front. I think people are now predicting anywhere between 50 high teen to maybe early 20s kind of a earnings growth coming through in FY18. My sense is that that number is probably going to be pared down as we go through CY17. So that's the earnings side. Now the PE side is a bit more difficult to actually visualize. I think the only thing that seems certain in that particular picture is that domestic money will still be fairly strong in 2017. We've seen 2 years, that is 2015 and 2016, being fairly strong years for inflows into MFs. I think that asset allocation will continue into 2017 is what my call is, because I think the other alternative asset classes are probably not going to be very attractive looking in 2017, especially real estate and, say, fixed deposits. So I would think that, there could be a fair amount of money coming in from the domestic front into MFs, and therefore into the markets, which could be probably the supporting factor for the market going forward. The FPI money is going to be very difficult to call. I think how things pan out from a global political standpoint and economic standpoint, it's a very difficult call to take. But I think these are the various variables which are going to come into play. So my basic call is a slightly cautious or slightly negative view going into the first half, or probably till 9 months, and then maybe towards the end of the year when people start looking out into FY19 and FY20, I think probably the market will perk up and we'll probably see Nifty at closer to 9,000 levels.
As far as Q3 and Q4 earnings are concerned, investors have already factored in that it's going to be weak and very difficult to predict. So try for FY18 or FY18 valuations.
Yeah, so I think markets broadly given up on Q3 and Q4 numbers, except for the fact that one really wants to know what how bad things are going to look like. We're talking specifically of domestic-oriented sectors. And what the commentary is going to be, is it going to be slightly positive at the margin? Would managements come out and say that the worst is behind them? My sense is I'm not very sure whether management themselves would have a good grip on it. Because as I said, there are events which are probably going to unfold in FY18, and at least the first half of FY18, which includes the GST and potentially, there is the other thing that is about implementation of the Real Estate Regulatory Act in one sense, which could be disruptive for the real estate sector going forward. So there are these measures which could probably come into play towards the middle or the second half of 2017, which could be disruptive for earnings. So therefore, yes, while Q3, Q4 would be bad and people are going to be watching out for commentary from the management, my sense is the management themselves and the investors are not going to be very certain of how earnings are going to pan out for domestic sectors in FY18. I think people will look for clues whether things are going to really settle down by second half of FY18, or it's going to drag on a little bit more. My sense is FY18 earnings still look very murky right now. I think the street is working with a fairly high number, which will have to come down. How much they're going to come down is the key issue. Every year, if you look at the last many years, we've had a situation where every year the market starts with an expectation that we'll probably see mid to high teen kind of index level earnings growth. And by the time the year ends, it's typically a low single digit or a mid single digit kind of earnings growth come through. And this year, we'll probably see no growth or probably close to zero growth come through on the earnings front. So I think that reset of expectations on FY18 has to happen. And that will probably keep investors a little wary of taking very big bets, but I think that is probably a good environment if one takes a 2 to 3 year view on the market. I think next 12 months could potentially give you very good entry points into domestic oriented sectors to take that 2 to 3 year view.
You mentioned about the DII flows being strong earlier. Say if the returns are the way they are, or returns start to turn negative, don't you see a lot of that money, going back or probably coming out of the system?
My sense is that it's all dependent on alternative investment avenues for retail investors. I think if I look at real estate, which is the largest asset class that retail investors have, a normal household has in India, which constitutes almost like 55-60% of a household's wealth, my sense is that is going to be at best flat. I would probably think under normal circumstances, you will probably see a downward drift in real estate prices. So there's going to be a slight price correction, probably a long time-wise correction in real estate, which is probably going to mean that that asset class is probably not an ideal one for a household for at least a few years. That's a point number one. Second, I think fixed deposit rates are probably headed lower. The very fact that the government had to come and fix a rate for senior citizens indicates that there is concern there on the government side in terms of where these interest rates are headed. So I would probably think that fixed deposit is probably not going to be a good asset to invest, put money in. So you have, when you eliminate some of these alternate asset classes, what is left is equities in one sense. And while at the index level, the market has probably not delivered much in the last couple of years, I think if you start looking at diversified mutual funds, I think they've delivered reasonable returns in the last couple of years. So I don't think there's any cost for, disillusionment in terms of from a person who's invested in MFs. In the last couple of years, I think some of the top quartile MFs would have delivered some fairly decent returns. So I think the SIP route has been a good one for most investors. I think there we're probably seeing about 4,000-5,000 crores come through on a monthly basis. I would probably think that number is going to remain there or probably go up a tad. Unless, of course, I mean, there is a big global event which is going to lead to a far greater outflow from the FPI side, which will lead to a big correction in the markets. That could temporarily be a setback for DII investors. But I would probably think that with the way, what the picture looks like across alternative assets, my sense is money has to flow into equities.
Right. NBFCs after correction, are they looking interesting, or do you think Q3 results or Q4 results and management commentary would probably decide how they perform?
Yeah, so NBFCs, I don't think there are any kind of great expectations from Q3, Q4 numbers for FY17. We do cover a few of them. We're covering the MFI space, and we cover the gold finance space. Of course, there are the HFCs and also, there are auto-related NBFCs and those which are focused on MSME finance. I would be a bit, if you look at Q3, Q4, I think across the board, you'll probably see pressure on earnings come through. But slightly, if you look from a 2 to 3 year perspective, I would probably think that one should be slightly underweight on those NBFCs which are more focused on, say, the housing as a product, be it housing finance or be it the LAP MSME finance, which has property as a collateral, because I think there we could probably see issues come through, which could be I think the growth could be an issue in terms of the asset growth could be an issue, margins could be an issue, asset quality could potentially be an issue in some of these NBFCs, but. The areas that we've kind of focused on, I think microfinance is currently seeing some bit of a problem currently, largely due to the lack of cash in the local rural economy at this point in time. I think that will probably improve. There have also been some concerns on the political side. There have been in Uttar Pradesh and in Maharashtra, there have been some concerns raised about, on the political front, where there have been some exhortations by politicians that the customers need not pay back to the MFI. So there have been these kind of issues that have come through on the MFI side, but I think that will probably get sorted out once elections in UP are through. So we think that is an area which has got a long runway. I think it's still a fairly underpenetrated asset class. And that too, it's more in the informal. See, that entire space is more on the informal side than the formal side. So we think that there's going to be a big migration coming into the formal MFI sector going forward from money lenders who've been operating in the rural areas. So that's an area we like. The other area we like is the gold finance space, where we think that the business model has been rejigged, which is going to make it more de-risked. And also the gold finance players are also diversifying themselves. And I would think that at the end of the day, they have a collateral which is fairly liquid in our opinion. And the rejig of the business model has led to a situation where, the auction losses that are going to come through are not going to be very dramatic. So these are the, within the NBFC space, that's an area that we kind of like. Though in the immediate term, I have my doubts whether we're going to see any kind of material price increase happening. But if one takes a two-year view, I would probably think that these are sub-segments of the NBFC space which will probably deliver some significant returns to investors.
Even banks, with the rate cuts that they are doing, you think could compete very well with housing finance companies, so a lot of growth could transfer to some of these banks?
Yeah, quite possible. I'm pretty sure that is definitely on the cards with the kind of cuts we've seen in recent times. While the headline cuts are almost like 90 basis points by SBI, for instance, I think the effective cuts are probably a little smaller than that. Yes, I think there is a case for share migration and the housing finance side from the NBFC space towards the these kind of banks who've probably brought down housing finance interest rates to as low as 8.7 or 8.75. So that is definitely a likely scenario which could probably put asset growth for HFCs under pressure, and probably margins are also going to be under pressure for some of these.
Right. Banks, but would you be overweight significantly on banks or MFI and gold finance that you just mentioned?
See, I think, one is a six-month view and one is probably a two-plus-year view. I think if you look at the next 6 months, my sense is some of the domestic focus sectors will probably face pressure. I would include banks in them. So I think there the uncertainty of earnings is going to be fairly high. So on a from a tactical, probably 3 to 6 month perspective, I think domestic sectors in general, I would probably think will underperform. But if you take a 2 year view, my sense is that, you know, some of the domestic sectors, and especially the top 2-3 players in the domestic sectors, are probably going to deliver a fair bit of revenue growth, which is going to probably outperform the nominal GDP growth, and earnings are probably going to be a little stronger than that. And that, in my opinion, is probably going to deliver the outperformance over the medium to longer term. So while in the very near term, over the next 6 months, some of these sectors are probably going to be not doing too well. But if you take a 2 to 3 year view, I would think that one really can't avoid investing in banks, because that's an overarching sector which is a play on both consumption and investment in India. And so if you believe that India has a growth story ahead of it, growing at least 7-8%, I would probably think banks is a good way to play. And both retail, private sector banks, and even good, well-run, corporate banks, I think if you take a 2 to 3 year view, that is an area one really, can't miss being invested in. So I would probably think that, yes, near term there could be issues, but it's not an area which one can ignore in a very big way if you have a longer term view on the Indian economy.
Consumption, you said, it would be a play on consumption as well. But overall on the consumption, consumer durables, valuations you think are demanding, or you would be overweight on it?
So consumer durables, we look especially at the electrical consumer space. So we think these are fairly high quality companies. I would think that valuations are fairly rich prior to demonetization. I think some of the valuations have corrected quite a bit because obviously there's been some demand destruction that has happened. But I think these are again very structural stories. I think these are players who've got very good return ratios and who in my opinion are probably going to deliver very steady revenue and earnings growth beyond say FY17 and FY18. And I think these are stocks that one should probably slowly accumulate in the next 6 to 12 months when there's going to be pain for some of these sectors. So I would continue to be bullish on these sectors with a medium term perspective. Yes, there could be near term issues in terms of revenue and earnings growth because of demonetization, because of GST, because of real estate regulatory authority related actions and stuff like that. So I think, as I said, it's going to be a situation where in the domestic side, you probably need to be a little underweight in the near term, but can't be hugely underweight because the medium term growth of these sectors are going to be significantly higher than the export oriented sectors going forward.
IT, you look at very closely, numbers would start coming out soon. Do you think IT could relatively do better than the index, because Q3 other numbers would tend to see a lot of problems, plus dollar was slightly higher, so that could also help the numbers?
Yeah, so I think if you look at the performance in Q3, if you look at performance of various indices in Q3, IT has actually outperformed quite a bit. And I think not on an absolute basis, I think on an absolute basis, the CNX IT index is probably up to 3%. But I think what on a relative basis, Nifty is probably down about 6 or 7%. So the outperformance from vis-a-vis Nifty has been pretty substantial. It's not that things are improving on the IT services front, except for the fact that rupee is probably depreciated a bit in the last few months. But I think the worry has been more from earnings of the domestic sector. So it's more a relative trade. So as I said, I think if you want to take a 3 to 6 month tactical view, probably IT will probably, my opinion, could potentially outperform even going forward, despite the outperformance one has seen in Q3, because there are domestic related speed breakers that could potentially hurt earnings in the first 9 months. So, structurally, I think this is a sector which is probably going to deliver, mid-single-digit kind of dollar revenue growth. And if rupee is kind, then I would probably think high single-digit kind of rupee revenue growth and earnings growth, which will probably at best, replicate the rupee revenue growth. So we'll probably see mid to high single-digit kind of earnings growth also come through, because I think there's going to be problems connect with margins going forward related to pricing pressure in the industry, the fact that there's going to be visa-related charges that are going to, be borne by some of these companies going forward. So I wouldn't be too bullish on the sector if I were to take a 2 to 3 year view. I would still be betting my money, big money, on the domestic sectors. Tactically, if you want to, if there's investor pressure or NAV pressure or, benchmarking pressure which comes through, I would say tactically, IT will probably do well in the next 3 to 6 months relative to the domestic players. But if you're not so worried about tactical performance, or if you're not going to be worried about near-term performance, but one is looking at a 2 to 3 year view, I would still be overweight the domestic players. See, I think IT has got its own set of big issues out here. I think the entire model is getting rejigged. Automation is going to lead to a situation where the labor cost arbitrage model that has been a big driver of competitive advantage of the industry is slowly kind of getting withered away. And I would probably think that the Indian industry is not as well prepared for the digital era, so to speak. I think the consultative skills are probably still not there. I think the competitive landscape is a lot more, I would say diversified in the digital space with players like, not just Accenture, there are a whole lot of other consulting firms also joining the race, so to speak. So digital is a slightly more competitive space at this point in time, and where I don't think Indian companies have been able to make as big a mark as, say, a player like Accenture has been able to do. While in the traditional service side, you have, the automation and the cloud actually leading to a situation where there's going to be a fair bit of compression of project sizes. So I think it is this that is leading to a situation where we're going to probably see, mid-single digit dollar revenue growth for the industry for some amount of time to come. I think that time could be as long as maybe two to three years. So one really doesn't know, how many players are going to be relevant, post 5 year time frame. Right now, the investors are kind of looking at 5 to 6 large players and a tail of smaller mid-cap players. So 5 years down the road, I would think that there's going to be some amount of consolidation, in the sense that there could be some of those five, six large players. There will probably be 2-3 which are probably going to make it or will still remain fairly relevant. And I would probably think a lot of the mid-cap players will probably be irrelevant in the next 5 year time frame. So that's the way I look at the IT service sector. Nothing, it's not a sector I'm bullish on. It's a sector where I think you should actually take money away from during this phase of relative outperformance that one is probably going to see in the next 6 months.
Girish, thank you so much for taking out time for us. Always a good to get in a perspective. That was a view coming in from Girish Pai.